lot of great businesses aren't quite so great as they used to be. The packaged good business for the Procter & Gamble's and so forth of the world, General Mills, they're all weaker than they used to be at their peak. And
the auto companies. I mean, when Charlie and I were...
Oh, my God. When I think of the power of General Motors when I was young and what happened, they wiped out all the shareholders. I would no more have predicted that. When I was young, General Motors loomed over the economy like a colossus. It looked totally invincible. Torrents of cash, torrents of everything.
Trying to hold down market share.
Yes, because they were afraid they'd be too monopolistic. And so the world changes, and we can't make a portfolio change every time something is a little less advantaged than it used to be.
But you have to be
alert.
You have to be thinking all the time in order to whether there's been something that really changes the game in a big way. And that's not only true for American Express. That's true for other things we own, including things we own 100% of. And we'll be wrong sometimes. We'll be late sometimes. We'll be wrong sometimes. But we'll be right sometimes, too. But it's not that we're not cognizant of threats. Assessing the probabilities of those threats being a minor problem or a major problem or a life-threatening problem is, you know, it's a tough game, but that's what makes our job interesting. In my view, there is no problem remotely like the problem of what I call CNBC, cyber, nuclear, chemical, and biological attacks that either by rogue organizations, even possibly individuals, rogue states. I mean, you know, you can think about a lot of things, and it will happen. I think we've been both lucky and, frankly, the people have done a very good job in government, because government is the real protection on this, in not having anything since 1945. We came very, very close during the Cuban Missile Crisis, and I don't know what the odds were, but I do think that if there had been, I can think of many people that if they'd been in place of either Kennedy or Khrushchev, we would have had a very different result. And it's the ultimate problem. It's, as I put in the annual report, it's the only real threat to Berkshire's economic, external threat to Berkshire's economic well-being over time. I just hope when it'll happen, I hope when it happens that it's minimized. But the desire of psychotics and megalomaniacs and religious fanatics and whatever to do harm on others is a lot more when you have 7 billion people on Earth than when you had 3 billion or so, which was the case when I was born. Less than 3 billion. And unfortunately, there are means of doing it. You know, if you were a psychotic back far enough, you threw a stone at the guy in the next cave, and there was a sort of linear relationship of damage to psychosis. But and that went along, you know, through bows and arrows and spears and cannons and various things. And in 1945, we unleashed something like the world had never seen, and that is a pop gun compared to what can be done now. So there are plenty of people that would like to cause us huge damage. And I came to that view when I was in my 20s, and in terms of my philanthropic efforts, I decided that that was one of two issues that I thought should be the main issue. And I got involved with all kinds of things like the Concern Union.
You supported the Pugwash Conference year after year, frankly, all by yourself.
Yeah, Union of Concerned Scientists. Money to the Nuclear Threat Initiative that is going to create a sort of a Federal Reserve System, a bank uranium that will take away some of the excuse for countries to develop their own highly enriched uranium. So, but it's overwhelmingly a governmental problem, and when you're dealing, and it should be, and I think it actually has been the top priority for president after president. It's not the thing they can go out and talk about every day, and they don't want to scare the hell out of everybody, and they also don't want to tip people's hands as to what they're doing. But being in the insurance business, you don't have to even be in the insurance business. You know that someday somebody will pull off something on a very, very, very big scale that will be harmful. Maybe the United States is probably the most likely place it happens, but it could happen a lot of other places. And that's the one huge disadvantage to innovation. I mean, people.
Warren, I think he also asked, why don't we, Berkshire, spend a lot more time telling the government what it should be doing and thinking?
Well, I've tried telling a lot of people. Nobody disagrees with you on it. It seems sort of hopeless to them. I mean, they don't know what to do beyond what they're doing. And incidentally, they've done a lot of things. I mean, not all gets publicized, but I think Kennedy and Khrushchev. I mean, Khrushchev shouldn't have been sending it over to Cuba, but at least he had enough sense when he knew Kennedy meant business to turn the ships around. But you can't count on there being Kennedys and Khrushchevs all the time in charge of things. And the mistakes that are made, I see the mistakes that are made in business or human behavior where people act so contrary to their own long-range self-interest that humans are very, they got a lot of frailties. You can argue that if Hitler hadn't been so anti-Semitic, he could have kept a lot of scientists that might have gotten him to the atomic bomb before we did, but he drove out the best of his scientific minds and fortune.
Imagine a guy stupid enough to think the way to improve science is to kick out all the Jews.
No. It was... No, the hero of the 20th century may have been Leo Szilard. I mean, Leo Szilard is the guy that got Einstein to co-sign a letter to Roosevelt and say, one side or the other is going to get this, and we better get it first, basically. He said it much more elegantly than that. You can go to the Internet and look up the letter, but we've both been good and we've been lucky. But if you remember post 9/11, people started getting a few envelopes with anthrax, and they went to like the National Enquirer and Tom Brokaw and Tom Daschle. I can't remember. Who knows what mind when you've got a mind that's going to send anthrax to people. How that decision-making is made is just totally beyond comprehension. And that person did not end up doing a lot of damage, but the capability for damage is absolutely incredible. I don't know how Berkshire does anything about that. I don't know how to do it philanthropically. If I knew how to reduce the probabilities of the CNBC type mass attack, if I knew how to reduce the probability by 5%, all my money would go to that. No question about that. Maybe 1%.
But hasn't it been true we haven't been very good at getting the government to follow any of our advice?
Yeah, but this one's important. Nobody argues with you about it. They just sort of throw up their hands. And some people work for a while on it and just get discouraged and quit. I was involved. I forget the exact name of it, but their idea was a bunch of nuclear scientists. This is long ago, but their idea was to affect elections in small states, the theory being that government was the main instrument and you would have the maximum impact. And I just one after another, people took it up and got discouraged. I don't think it's because we've had the wrong leaders have been good on this. I think that any candidate I do not worry about the fact that either Clinton or Trump would regard that as the paramount problem of their presidency. But I just don't know. And the offense can be ahead of the defense, and that's you can win the game 99.99% of the time, but eventually anything that has any probability of happening, you know, will happen. I wish I could give you a better answer.